Church. My name's Ken, and I'm so glad to be a part of our worship service today. Excited about what God's going to be doing. It's at the movies at Hope Church today. Can I hear a crowd out there today? Awesome. We're going to have a great time. This is going to be a great series, all right? So we want you to be mindful of inviting folks out. It's going to be a different atmosphere, different experience, but it's going to be a great opportunity to learn God's truth. And so we want to encourage you to be inviting folks out. But before I get ahead of myself, if you're a guest this morning, thanks so much for being a part of our service. You'll notice in the seat in front of you, there's a Connect card. If you'll take that out, you can use the QR code or you can fill it out and place that in the offering box as you leave today. And we just are so glad that you came out to be a part of the day with us. Want to send you a thank you. And if you're online, thanks for tuning in today. You're certainly an honored guest as well. Thanks for being a part of our service today. And so we're excited about the series, and if you haven't got your popcorn yet, it's not too late. Get some popcorn, but we'll be eating popcorn on Sunday morning in worship service for a few weeks, so get your popcorn fill, all right? And then we're excited about what we're going to be learning in God's Word, and then also we want to be excited about August 13th is our Back to School Sunday, and we want to be mindful of students and teachers and bus drivers and coaches and all the support staff, the auxiliary staff, anybody that's involved in school, principals, everybody. If you know someone, invite them to come out to our Back to School Sunday. And we're going to just have a great time to pray over all that are going to be involved in this next school year and just ask God to accomplish great things in our students and in what they're going to be learning and in our community. We need that. Amen? We need that. So be prayerful about that. It'll be a great Sunday to invite folks to come out and be a part of the day with us. Let's pray together. Father, you're so good to us, and we're thankful for the creative ways that we can go about sharing the gospel with others. And even today, as we've come into our facilities here in Sunnyvale, and Lord, we just be able to have a good time together as we just think about you and take some things that people are aware of, things that people are familiar with, and to help them to see truth even in that and show that as something that they'll never forget the next time they see it again. They'll be mindful of you. So God, help us to learn today what you have for us. We ask that you'll be with us as we reach out into our community this coming weeks as we try to see people come and be a part of these services, Lord. We pray for those that don't know you that will be able to come and hear the gospel. And we pray that you'll send them and And then also, Lord, that we'll be faithful to be inviting, and Lord, that we'll see people here on the 13th to honor those that are involved in school. And Lord, just to send everybody back into school with prayer and knowing that, Lord, we need you to accomplish much in school. And so we ask for your protection, your guidance, and all of that. Bless the word as it goes out today. May you be glorified in all these things, in Jesus' name.
Once in the wilderness of my sin, we wandered lost and without hope. Into our desert waste, God in grace came to restore and bring us home. Let the redeemed of God rise up and sing. We give thanks, oh God, for your steadfast love. We give thanks, oh God, for you are good. Lord, you are good. We give thanks. Through every pain and trial, my light in the dark of our distress, lifting us from on high when we cry, turning our grief to gratefulness. Let the redeemed of God rise up and sing. We give thanks, oh God. Make it as light. Hearts that were dead in sin, you raise to life. You take a barren place and make it a spring. Let the redeemed of God rise up and sing. Let the redeemed of God rise up and sing. Give thanks, oh God, for your steadfast love. We give thanks, oh God, for you are good. Lord, you are good. We give thanks, oh God, for your steadfast love. We give thanks, oh God, for you are good. Lord, you are good. Love, we give thanks, oh God, for you are good. Lord, you are good. We give thanks, oh God, for your steadfast love. We give thanks, oh God, for you are good. Lord, you are good. We give thanks.
God of covenant and faithful promises, what you said. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast and let my heart learn. When you speak a word, it will come to pass. Great is your faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting same, I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to me.
Faithfulness to me.
Father, you're so good to us. Thank you for being faithful. Thank you for drawing us to yourself with your Holy Spirit. Thank you for the truth of the gospel that we, Lord God, we have relationship with you. And you know the end from the beginning. And so, God, we trust you today with our lives, Lord, our problems, our circumstances, our joys, our sorrows. Lord, today we exalt you and we ask you to be glorified in this service. Now bless the word as it goes out, Lord, and may we all be better because we've been here. In Jesus' name.
Good to see everyone here this morning. If you don't know, my name is Mike. It's a joy to be one of the pastors of Hope Church and to serve with you guys for quite a while now, but we're not talk about that. Welcome to At the Movies. Excited to be at the movies this morning. We're going to watch a couple clips. We're not going to play the whole movie, so if you thought that, sorry. Okay, you can go home and watch the rest of the movie. All right, but we are excited. Movies are fun, so we hope you have fun during this series. We want you to have fun. God is a God of fun, okay? And so we want to have fun. And on a side note, if you're a person that goes to the movies to watch scary movies or horror movies, something wrong with you. I don't know why you want to go and pay to be scared. Didn't know Brother Roy was here today. Praise God, bro. Good to see you. Didn't know you're going to make it. Amen. God's good. So we'll celebrate that. So we're not going to do scary movies. We're going to do fun movies for the most part. They're all going to be super fun. But we're going to have the fun, but then we want to pull out biblical truths. We want these movies to point us to, because they do, whether we see it or not all the time, to principles in Scripture. So that's our goal. But as we get started, I want you to think about one or two things that if people ask you, they meet you, you get to talking, and they say, hey, what do you do for fun? They ask you that question. In your spare time, what do you do for fun? And if you're the guy that always says, or the person that always says, spare time, what's that? I never have, forget that. Let's assume you have some spare time. What do you like to do for fun? Is it one thing, a couple things, whatever those are? I want you to think about that and just kind of hold it in your head. You know me pretty well if you do. I love to play golf. Like to go to movies, watch movies with Kim, the kids, if they come watch movies. I don't like golf so much where we almost die, like yesterday. It's so hot. We're idiots. I don't know what we're doing out there. But when it's good weather, it's good to get out and play golf. That's one of mine. But whatever yours is, hold on to it for a minute, and at the end of the service, we'll look at it, okay? We'll talk about it a little more. We're in James 4 today, though. James is talking about just some ways how you live life. How do you go about... making decisions to live your life, okay? How do you do these? What do you think about when you do it? Verse 13, James 4, he says, come now you who say, today or tomorrow we're going to go into such and such a town and spend a year there. We're going to trade. We're going to make profit. He says, yet you do not even know what tomorrow will bring. I want you to see that James is not talking about the fact that if you are a planner, we've got any planners in the room, right? You need to know what's coming next. Nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with planning and making plans for something in the future. Kim and I went to the beach for a week. There's planning goes along with that. I need to know which Mexican food restaurant we're stopping at on the way, and if we're going to see a different one on the way back, where are we stopping? What are we doing? Planning is not ungodly. Now, if you got someone that plans you to the moment and you're like, give me a break, woman. Okay, maybe you need to work through that. You can't be perfect, but making plans is not bad. Ordering things, putting things in order is not bad. But he says in verse 15, if you just say it that way, here's my plans, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, I'm going to do that. Instead, you should say this: if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. If it's God's will, this is what we're planning to do. Right? When we say, hey, I'll see you Sunday, Lord willing. Why? Because God's in control. It's not us. So he is saying that if your God is the God of the Bible, if your God is the creator and sustainer of life, God of the Bible, okay, then everything in your life, whether you go here or there, is under his control. So we have to have that mindset. What is God doing? Is he in control of your life? And do you acknowledge that? We left for the beach on the 16th of July, and we get driving. We hit the first stop sign out of town, no big deal. I said, hey, babe, you want to pray for our trip? She starts praying. I realize she's crying. Oh, what did I do? What did I forget? I'm driving. It wasn't me. She's done. I said, you okay? She goes, yeah, I'm so thankful that God's allowing us to do this. She didn't grow up having family vacations. I grew up maybe with a weekend to Meridian State Park. I mean, that was family vacation. So God is good. She was just thankful that he's allowing, he's put that in place. And before you think we're always super spiritual like that, that's not the case. But we're taking a 10, 11 hour trip. And so our mind is geared towards God, that he's going to lead us and direct us as we ask him to do so. In Acts 18, Paul says, as he's leaving the temple, he says, I will return to you if God wills. They ask him to stay a little longer. And he says, hey, I'll come back if God wills, if he allows. 1 Corinthians 4, he says the same thing. I will come to you soon if the Lord wills. So it's a mindset of knowing that it's all in God's control. And James is wanting us to think about, if we're not careful, there's this underlying, almost hidden arrogance to our lifestyle. You don't think about it, but it's there. We think we run things. We think we're in charge. He says it in verse 16. As it is, you boast in your arrogance, and all such boasting is evil. So if you thought, hey, we're going to go to a movies, it's going to be at the movies, at the church, it's going to be fun, and then I find out that if I don't say if God wills, I'm evil. But he's saying that it's that underlying arrogance where you don't think you have to depend on God. That is sinful. It is evil. The evil word, the Greek is poneos, and it means evil, bad, wicked, malicious, slothful. So when we think we're in charge and we do whatever we want to do, and yeah, maybe God bless us if you want, but this is where we're going. This is what we're doing. Right? He says in verse 17, so whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, for him it is sin. So you might have learned about a new sin today. Just not giving God credit for working in your life. Just not verbalizing, oh, Mike, I knew that. It's not just knowing it, because what you know and what's in your heart comes out in the way you speak. Right? Most of you know some of your own sin tendencies. Like, you know, man, if I get off track, I kind of slide this direction. And you're like, I didn't know there's this new one. I'm gonna hit upside the head with a new sin because I don't give God credit for his will being what directs my life with my words. Arrogance and pride's at the core when we live and talk this way. Like we have no consideration if God's in control or if we need his blessing. So we don't want that. Words actually matter because they stem from your heart. Words actually matter because you speak what you believe, and so do I. But go back to verse 14. There's a second part of verse 14 we skipped. Because he says, what is your life? For you are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. Watch this first clip from Rocky.
Hey, you got something for me?
Yeah, there was some guy here from Miles Juggins looking for you. They need sparring partners for Apollo Creed.
Put me on.
Here's a car.
When was it here?
About an hour ago.
They're probably looking for sparring partners for Creed, you know?
I said that before, you dumb dago. You know, I've been coming in for 6 years, and 6 years you've been sticking it to me. I want to know how come.
You don't want to know.
Yeah, I want to know how come.
You want to know?
I want to know!
Okay, I'm going to tell you. Because you had the talent to become a good fighter. And instead of that, you became a leg breaker to some cheap second-rate loan shark.
It's a living?
It's a waste of life.
I don't know if you remember that. It's the original. It's the first Rocky, the very first one. And could you hear all the words pretty clearly? Is it okay? Rocky needs Mickey to let him know that you are slowly, moment by moment, week by week, year by year, wasting your God-given talent and wasting your life. You're living life how you want, and you are wasting your life. There's something better for you. There is something more for you. Why is he giving him such a hard time? Because guess what? Mick knows life is fleeting. Talk to an older person, and they will tell you how quickly life ebbs away. And Rocky doesn't get it. He's working for a loan shark. Called him a leg breaker. All right, you don't pay up, we just snap your knee. It's how we roll. And it's a living, it's a waste of life, Mick says. You are wasting your life. So James is saying, when you just plan your life, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, why do you live and act as though you have some source of unlimited time? Because guess what? You do not. I do not. Time runs out. We lose time. Job says it in chapter 8, 9, and 14, verse 9 of chapter 8. We are but of yesterday and know nothing, for our days on earth are a shadow. Chapter 9, my days are swifter than a runner. They flee away. They see no good. They go by like skiffs of reed, like an eagle swooping on the prey. And in Job 14, verse 1 and 2, man who is born of a woman is a few days and full of trouble. He comes out like a flower and withers. He flees like a shadow and continues not. Whether you think this or not, life truly is short. It goes by quicker than you realize, quicker than you think it ever could. One day you're 16, then you're 29, then you're 45, then you're 61. And you're like, what happened? I don't know what happened. I was rolling the ball to my son on the floor, you know, and now he's taking me out for dinner on his own dime. That's cool when that happens. But it is so brief. Life is short and brief. And that's what James is telling us. You're planning as though it's everything's just going to be here forever. James is saying that it's ignoring God's will is not only foolish because you're ignorant of the future, it's foolish because you're so frail, so fragile, so vulnerable to this life that we're living in. How ridiculous to plan as if you were eternal, to plan as if you're almighty, that if you are the all-knowing. Look at the second video clip. I love this one.
Damn, Ron, come on! What's the matter with you?
Tomorrow. Let's do it tomorrow.
There is no tomorrow! There is no tomorrow! There is no tomorrow!
Five more left. Watch it. There you go. Come on.
Sylvester Stallone once said, it's only the magic of movie making that would make it look like Rocky could actually beat Apollo Creed in a race. Because there's no way in real life. But in this movie, this is Rocky III, and Rocky's about to have a rematch with Clubber Lang, played by Mr. T. And Apollo knows that if Rocky isn't tuned in and laser-focused, Clubber Lang's going to destroy him. He's too big, too strong. He's fast as a big, strong guy. And Rocky has to change his whole thing, and Rocky isn't feeling it. He said, hey, let's just try again tomorrow. And he knows that every hour counts, right? Every training session counts. So he screams at him at the beginning, there is no tomorrow. If you're going to do this every day, every minute, every moment, every practice, every ball you throw, every ball you catch, every swing of the bat, swing of the club, every time you hit the punching bag, it all matters, and it matters now. There is no, it's like, we'll just try, let's take off early today. Clubber Lang's going to kill you. Well, let's just do half a day tomorrow. Clubber Lang's going to kill you. There is no tomorrow. It's now or never. We're going to do this or not. Jesus said this in John 9. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day, because night is coming when no one can work. There is a tension and a pressure to living life in a way that honors God in a world of people that do not. To the tune of there is no tomorrow, because there's going to be a time when you're in my opportunities to work and to share the gospel and to invite someone, those opportunities will be gone. No more chance to help someone know how deeply they are loved by God. And what a sweet, precious, unimaginable gift God gave us in his son, Jesus Christ. There's going to be a time when that is no longer possible. John 4, Jesus said to them, my food, my sustenance, the thing that keeps me going is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work. He said, do you not say, there are yet 4 months, then comes the harvest? Jesus says, look, I tell you, lift up your eyes, see that the fields are white for harvest now. And there can be no harvest without harvesters. The crops do not jump out of the ground into the baskets so you can carry them in and eat. You have to get out with your hands and feet and do the work. God will grow them, but then they'll sit there and wither and die if someone doesn't harvest them. He's doing the work of sunshine and rain, but he needs us to do the work of harvesting. He says, and the time is now. The time is now. So we began this message. I said, think of something. If someone asked you, what do you like to do for fun? You would say, it could be one or two things. It could be more. But like, man, oh, I love if I had time to do this. I hope you truly found one. You say, I don't do fun anymore. I'm too old. No, I hope you found something that's fun for you. This summer, I spent about 3 weeks with this young kid, 10 years old, going into fifth grade, tutoring him. Kim knows the family, and so he needed some help, named Matthew. He's a great kid. But he's going into in-person school for the first time in 2 years. He's been at home watching videos. The mom and dad said the school video lasted about 45 minutes, then he was on his own. So he has fallen behind, to say the least, in mostly his writing. He's smart as a whip. If he did an aptitude test or an IQ test, he's super smart. But he has this issue when it comes to doing work. He finds it really hard to let go of the things he would rather be doing than writing. He's all about fun, which is video games and YouTubers. I said, so you don't watch TV or movies? I watch YouTube. I said, what do you watch on YouTube? YouTubers. Just people on YouTube making videos, and he just watches them, and he plays video games. That's it. Roblox. I don't know if anybody's ever heard of Roblox. He loves Roblox and all the games. Oh, yeah. So we got some Robloxers. I didn't even know what it was. I had to look it up so I could talk intelligently with him. But he won't get the smart out unless he's willing to put the fun away and do the work. And sometimes we fall in the very same thing. We have things we like that we love to do, right? The fun. And it keeps us from putting in the work at the things we know we should be doing. Like, we don't want to think about the things I should be doing. Yeah, I told Kim I'd work on that, but look at this movie that's on. or I'll go chip and putt for a little while. Right? We like the fun too much. In 1 Peter 4:2, he says, the goal is to live for the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for human passions, but for the will of God. Saying that there are passions, there are things you're passionate about, and it's good. But I can't live for those. I've got to live for what God's called me to be and called me to do. So when believers look at the model of Christ, what we see between Jesus and God is perfect obedience. We look at our own obedience, it's imperfect, isn't it? We don't just perfectly do everything God wants us to do. Sometimes we get lazy, we get lack, we push that aside and we do what we want instead. But your desire to honor God with your life and be obedient and to do the work he's called you to is a marker of your relationship with him. That you have a desire to do his will. Listen, on the other hand, if there's not a desire in your heart to do the will of God, it can be a mark of a rebel, the mark of one who has not been transformed by Christ, the mark of someone who does not love God. It's one of those things we talk about a lot of times. This kind of measures your commitment to Jesus Christ. Well, I don't like doing that at all. Okay, well, it kind of is a barometer of your level of commitment to Jesus Christ. And the same for me. John 5, Jesus said again, I seek not my own will, but the will of him who sent me. I have a will. I just have to push it down sometimes and be about God's will first for my life. That's why we're here as a church. That's why Hope Church is here. We seek to do the will of God, to be his church, and to help others come to know and follow Jesus Christ. That's why we meet. That's why we gather. That's why we have things happening at our church. It's for that reason. It's why our people serve faithfully every week. John's going to come up and start playing, so we're going to wrap this up. But I might ask you today if you're a member of Hope Church. Like, you're a member. This is your church. I went to a funeral on Friday, and they always list if they had a church home, he was a member, she was a member of such and such church. If you say, when I pass, they're going to say that at my funeral, member at Hope Church. If that's you, are you actively serving God through your church? Do you have a role? Is there something that you put fun aside so that you can do the work that helps propel the gospel through Hope Church? I don't know if you know this, but every Sunday when we worship, we're in here for about an hour, hour 10. There are people that have set aside what they would like to do, being here for corporate worship, so that they can serve everyone else. They work in the kids' classes, the kids' ministry. They work in the nursery. They work in the concessions and the snacks. They work at the greeters and the security team. That God forbid, if something were to go down bad that happens in this world, we've got men out there ready to alert us and help and take care. They are giving up what they would choose to do. They love to be in here sitting with their wife, with their husband, whatever, but they're serving others. There are even more during the week, outside of this day and this hour, that give of their time. They set some of their personal fun time aside, and they help serve. We have ladies that clean the building every week because they love the Lord and they love their church and they love y'all. So when you come in, it's clean on Sunday morning. They put their time aside and they do that. We have others that work and help with graphics and decor and landscaping and repairing things that some of y'all break. Other things requiring time outside of this 1 hour. But guess what? Our lives are meant to be spent and lived going after the will of God. And because God is so good, by his grace, he lets us have some of the things we love as well. That's a God thing. If you found something you love and you like to do in your spare time, that's because God has been good to you. But it's a byproduct of putting him first and serving him and seeking his will. But life cannot all be about that grace. God, thank you for the grace of loving God. That's all I'm going to do. It can't be all about that. You and I cannot live our lives just how we want, going and doing whatever pleases us, and at the same time honor God. It's one or the other. If you and I just make our own plans, do our own thing all the time, never considering serving God in any capacity or serving others because of God, we don't get anything done for Him. We live our life, as Mick said, wasted. The very life that God has blessed you with and given you, we live it wasted. Let me ask you this, if you're part of the church again, if you love your church, and every week we have people telling us how much they love the church, and this is the church, the people. If you love your church and you're so grateful for your community that helps you through all the ups and the downs in your life, what do you think about others that don't know God and don't have a church right now? Why would we want to say, I love my church so much, I'm so glad what I have, I don't care if y'all have it. Let's let more people enjoy the blessing of God's church. The community that comes from brothers and sisters in Christ that care for and pray for one another when things are going rough and come alongside and help when things go sideways. Because Jesus said there's coming a day when no man can work. When you won't have the opportunity, I won't have the opportunity to go ask someone to come be your guest. Hey, come to worship service with me this Sunday. You know what? None of us know when we'll draw our last breath. We don't know when that friend, that coworker, that neighbor, when it might be their very last time for you to see them and ask them to come be your guest at church service. To ask them if they have a faith in God. Truly, for some people, we don't even know who they are. There is no tomorrow. We just don't know. So we have to live our day like there is no tomorrow. Every single day. For God's honor, for His glory. That's our task. That's our challenge. I'm going to ask you to stand for just a minute this morning with me. Thank you if you've listened to the message this morning and you're not a Christian. You'd say, I'm not a Christian. I'm not a follower of this Jesus you're talking about. I've heard about Him. I've seen Him in the manger at Christmas time, but I'm not a follower. I wouldn't call myself a Christian. I want you to know that the message today is not a scare tactic. We're not trying to just get you all nervous and scary like in a scary movie so you'll make a decision or a proclamation. It's just truth. It's facts from the Bible. None of us know our last breath. None of us know our last day on earth. None of us know it. That moment when you will have your last opportunity, if you're not a Christian, your very last opportunity to put your belief in the God of the Bible and trust His Son, Jesus Christ, with your life. If that's you, you're listening online or you're here, don't wait. Because we're all going to face that moment where we draw our last breath. Every one of us. And I hope you would do that knowing in your heart that the God of the Bible is the God of the world, God of the universe, giver and sustainer of life, and that you're His child. Because you put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. That's what we want for you here at Hope Church. If you're not a Christian this morning, we want you to come to that knowledge where you know that you're God's son or daughter. And we'd like to help you get there. We'd love to spend some time with you. Just let us know. We'll spend some time with you. We'll walk through that so you can start your journey of faith as a child of God. That's our prayer for you. But if you are a Christian, you say, Mike, I've been following Christ. Not always perfectly, for sure, because we're imperfect, but I strive to follow Christ. Here's my question. Is it your strong desire to do God's will with your life? Is it your strong desire to be faithful to the one that is always faithful to you? Is that what drives you? Because a constant disregard or a disinterest in the will of God is a pretty sure evidence of the presence of pride in your life. And that arrogance that James is talking about. It was a great opportunity this morning to root that out. Just root it out. Cut out that arrogance and pride. And say, God, it's by your hand that I live and breathe. It is by your hand that I prosper and have blessings and get to enjoy things. and praise God's name and recommit yourselves. I don't want to be the ruler of my life anymore. I don't want to think like I've got it all wrapped up and I'm in control. God, I'm letting you, I'm acknowledging your control in my life. It'll show. If you and I are living faithful to God and striving for his kingdom work and his doing his will, it'll show in the way we live and the way we talk. People think, you know, why do you keep saying God's, if it's God's will, God's will? Because I serve him, I love him. He orchestrates my days. He gives me the breath that I wake up with every morning, and I want to honor him with my life. He's worth it. God is worth it. Father, we pray this morning that as we walk through the message and we look at your truths and we take a clip here and there from a movie, God, to make it fun, God, that you touched our hearts where you wanted to touch our hearts today. That if we've been on the sidelines of your work, that God, you've kind of kicked us in the tail to get us to step up. Say, God, we want to serve you. We want to be actively seeking your will. Thank you, God, for the challenge, for the little kick in the tail that we need from time to time, God. Thank you so much for that. And then, God, for those who've heard the message and they would say they're not Christian, God, continue to work in their heart. Continue to pull at their heartstrings where they know that there's this pull and it's you, God. It's your Holy Spirit pulling them, wooing them. Help them to know there's nothing we want to hear more than that they're ready to follow your Son, Jesus Christ. Let us come alongside and help them, God. We pray that you do this work in our hearts. We give you the room, the time, work in our hearts for your honor and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh, come behold the works of God, the nations at his feet. He breaks the bow and bends the spear and tells the wars to cease. O mighty one of Israel, you are on our side. We walk by faith in God who burns the chariots with fire. Lord of hosts, you're with us in the fire, with us as a shelter, with us in the storm. You will lead us through the fiercest battle. Oh, where else would we go but with the Lord of
roar, you are the Lord of all. Father, we thank you for the time that we can come and pull from a movie that a lot of us have seen, Father, and apply biblical truths. Father, I ask that you would go and help us to apply them. I ask that you would be with us as we go, that we could impact the world for you. We love you, and we thank you for all that you do for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Y'all are dismissed to go in peace, to love and serve the Lord.